It all started back in school, I guess. I was a very timid child growing up in a small village in Kerala. I was the only child of my parents, and I was cocooned and shielded significantly by them through everything that I did. And as a result, I ended up being a person who had always somebody to look up to as a support system, which ended up making me an intrinsically conservative, afraid person. So to the large extent, my mom once mentioned that crossing the level railway track to reach my school has cobras in it. So every other time I used to get a scratch on my leg, I used to invariably believe a cobra has bitten me. And twice I even convinced my mom to take me to the doctor to ensure that it was not a snake bite. So I'm that degree petrified. What that resulted in is that I grew up to my teens as a person who wanted to be known as a successful, confident, interesting, cool person. So the more I wanted to do that, more facades I started putting to myself. And the more facades I put, more number of times that facade got broken. So I ended up being a person who was largely just afraid of everything. You know what a typically afraid person does? Any ideas? We do what is called as shoring ourselves. We do safe things. Like, you know, when you're afraid, you actually do things that you're sure will not cause you any harm. So that is why I took a very important decision of my life, which was to do engineering. Every other guy I met told me that it shores you, it gives you a great life, and, you know, it is the best thing that could happen to you. And everybody that is doing arts and commerce are just, anyway, so I just thought they were right. And it all sounded really too good to believe in. And just like that, I went to an engineering college. It's a different question for a different day whether anybody and everybody that goes to engineering really kind of consider whether they have the aptitude or they actually even like the subject. But in retrospect, when I think, I had no idea what I was doing there. I went there, it was great. And like, you know, I grew up in Kerala, and I was happy in Kerala. Kerala is the kind of state that makes you believe that outside of Kerala, there is really nothing. Anybody from Kerala would know. So we have everything in Kerala. Like, if you look to the west, you get the mountains, and you look to the east, you get the, is it the other way around? You know, so the problem with Malayalis is that if you don't understand Malayalam, it's your problem. So I had all these characteristics in me. Like, you know, I was extremely proud of the fact that I only speak Malayalam. But then I went to a place in rural Rajasthan called Pilani. As much as I could not find Pilani in the map of India, people in Pilani couldn't find Kerala in the map of India. So it is an incredibly good situation to be in. And most of the people over there, at least till I found the first Malayali on campus, nobody spoke Malayalam. And interestingly, I can't speak anything else with a lot of pride. I just thought it was cool to not, like, you know, I've said this before. So incidentally, I'm now afraid, right? I am in a place which everybody said is going to be great and my career is going to be built and life is going to be good. And I can't even speak to anyone. So I thought, let's go find all the Malayalis in campus. Let's hustle up and form a consortium of Malayalis. But most of the Malayalis on campus were like, actually, dude, I don't want to hang out with you. Unlike you, I can actually speak English. Some amount of Tamil, some amount of Hindi. So the first thing that I started realizing is that, like, you know, so cocooning myself, trying to run away from the fact that I can't do a few things, was the first place I realized that was when I realized I had to find out ways to speak to people and try to gel myself. I'm an introverted person outside of Malayalis. So I started learning how to speak English, some amount of Hindi, and today I'm extremely proud, actually. I can speak 5 languages. I can speak Kannada, Telugu, Tamil, Malayalam, English, Hindi. So, yeah, I have like 3 or 4 such punchlines which will get cheers today. So, one is done. Let's get to the next one very quickly. It's a short set. Anyway, but the problem with engineering is that it's apparently interesting in certain subjects. In certain subjects, not so much. I studied chemical engineering. Woohoo. I mean, I'm sure the subject makes sense. The point I'm trying to make is it made no sense to me. It continues to not make any sense to me, and that's my problem. But I was supposed to take a degree in chemical engineering. To the extent sometimes I started, I think the first 2 years is fine, you're studying with everyone and the subjects make no sense to many of the people, so you're kind of together. But then all these computer science electronics guys will start getting into their zone in the third year. A lot of engineers here would understand. Then they start liking it. And then here I am, I'm not liking it. I'm not liking it for different reasons, because I remember a guy walking out of the microprocessor lab saying, I'm resting my neck because it's too much staring at the computer. I am actually mixing calcium carbonate in a bucket. And my experiments are even funnier. Anybody from chemical here, guys, woo-hoo. But anyway, right. We were a minority always. Is that all the three people on campus who are studying chemical engineering? I heard like three voices exactly. I'm sorry. I'm sure there are more who don't want to relate to this, but anyway, I still vividly remember doing boiling kettle experiment, which is exactly the following. You boil some water in a kettle and do a whole bunch of calculations. And chemical engineering is a fascinating subject. The variables have run out, so they use theta 1, theta 2, epsilon 1. So, I mean, we have exhausted English and never mind. So, I decided to run away from chemical engineering, clearly, because I'm afraid. And my grades were going all the way down. I was scared. My parents are being summoned. And my dad has only one wish, which is that my son finishes in 4 years. Like, this is one thing where he was like really hoping I'll get out in 4 years. So he just said, kind of, find your way, bro. So I found a way. I found an interesting way, which is to start practicing, till that point, a rather elusive ability of mine, which was to sing. The problem is, I think I have mentioned this in another talk of mine. The problem is I was trained in Carnatic music. The format is as interesting as the nighttime routine of your neighbor's cat. It's that boring. Number of young people here, like, you know, the best generation ever, how many of you have really gone to a Carnatic concert? Not many would have gone. I myself don't go for it. It's pretty boring. But that's the only format I knew. And here we are talking about... And mind you, I went to all-boys school, all-boys college. My real chance of asking a girl what time it is was zero. So with all these put together, I thought pursuing music was good for my social equity. So I started pursuing music, and in retrospect, that turned out okay, because apparently there are other styles of music outside of Carnatic music that you could listen. First time I heard a thrash metal band, I thought that guy was in pain. The next time I heard dubstep, I thought the aliens were talking to us. But in between all that, I started following different forms of music, and by the end of 4 years, which I graduated in time, by the way, due to constellation repositions, and Bits wanted me to be out. So, they couldn't take the agony anymore. So, I had more aptitude in music, but now I have two important things. I have, my insecurities are multiplied because I am in the bottom 5% of my class. My CGPA is just north of 5 on a scale of 10. I have no real chance of making any meaningful job, but mind you, I made a job. But secondly, I was wanting to pursue music, but I'm afraid. Everybody told musicians either die of penury or they die of diseases you don't want to talk about. You know, so... It's not a happy prospect to be a full-time musician, because I don't like to be hungry. And in the whole process, I'd like to be a little rich. So I look for the next safe option, which is running away from my fears, is to take a job. And the company that offered me a job told me, come after 6 months. I waited for 6 months, then they told me to come after 6 months. That doesn't make sense. So by that point, I have gotten to a place where I understood I'm 21 years old, and I am literally not capable of doing anything. What I'm capable of doing is to just look for simple solutions, go to the shore, and look to the other side and wonder what great things are on offer, and somebody's going to take me there. Because the only emotion I have about taking a chance or taking a risk is somebody actually taking me along. Somebody had to push me into the deep end. That's when I will get started. And that happened. So I joined a company that was started by three of my seniors. And I was the guy that bought coffee, cleaned the washroom, and also wrote some code. And within 7 months of our operation, we ran out of cash. And we had to wind down the company. And anybody who's from a middle-class background in coming from South India, if your son is laid off, it's problematic. You're not going to get married. For many of us, that is the aspiration that we are living for. Like pretty much live a life without a girlfriend. You get married and you need to kind of make a family and make your parents proud, have children, and then grow old and wait for them to have children. So, so I got laid off. When I got laid off, I was wondering, what am I doing? So I just decided to pursue my music a little more seriously. So that was the first ever point I understood that it is actually all right to be not very concerned about what is the safest place to be in. So that is the starting point of what we call today as Agam, a band that I represent, a band that I co-founded back in the day. Through the years, two to three things happened. I started getting more and more involved in my music, but at the same time, I kept my job because I have continuously maintained that I don't have the courage and energy and I don't have the sheer determination required to be a full-time musician, because every time I try to be a full-time musician, I wonder, will the SMS clink on the first day of the month with the salary? So I am driven by the fact that there should be always a little bit of a cushion. There should be a little bit of what you call as a safety net, as they call it in middle-class world. Another 4 years passed, and this now I have started getting frustrated because pretty much nothing has happened through my whole time, and I'm just living this super mediocre existence of really not achieving anything. And that is when the first critical instance in my life happened. I took a job in US within Adobe, the company that I was working for. And that was my first ever exposure to actually starting up myself. So I went to the US to start out a new project where I had no team, no mentorship, and really no understanding of how a business is run. And arguably, with all my abilities, I ran that down to the ground in 4 months. And I did not have a job again. So I got sent back in a span of 1 year. And once I came back to India, I decided to do two things. I am going to leave the steady nature of the job that I am in, and I'm going to go and jump into an industry which is going to give me a little more fear as a byproduct. So that was my first exposure to being a startupper. So I joined this company called Myntra. I hope everybody knows Myntra. So I joined Myntra as their head of design to build their first ever mobile strategy. And if anybody is aware, the e-commerce crash happened, where all the companies ran out of money, and within a span of 6 months, I did not have a job again. So technically, I have now survived a life of utter mediocrity with zero real achievement. So I decided to focus back in my band. So this is 2010. So I stopped going to the barber, because apparently I was not cool enough to play at a club or a similar venue in Bangalore, and I did not know the importance of the optics and the cosmetics of being in the entertainment industry. I did the same thing then. I just got some body art, you can't see it, and I also started growing my hair, and interestingly enough, people thought that was enough. Nobody really cared about what music. I was still playing the same music, which was pretty bad at that time, but I got a chance to play music, so that took off, and now I have become a person who actually started thinking, okay, I have done it, I have a band, plus I am also kind of operating in a startup setup, which is a company called FreeCharge, which I joined as the first or the second employee. And the most definitive moment of my life happened right there. In 2014, I was performing at a concert in Calicut, and I passed out on stage. And everybody thought I was either tired or I was under influence or something was wrong, pretty much including the doctors. But the reality was that I actually had a massive heart attack on stage. And they revived me in a span of 9 hours with 43% damage to my heart. but I survived. And that, my friend, is real fear. And that fear shakes you up. Like when I came out of that, by then I was a father of a 2.5-year-old. I had a family and I had people's faces that I could see. So that fear shook me up, and I had only two directions to go. One is to be perpetually scared, because my doctor said, you might want to retire into a rather stable job and not do all this touring around and doing all this fun stuff that you want to do. Or you can make a choice of doing what you like and then face the consequences. I decided to face the consequences, by the way. I am at 192 concerts after that. Sometimes you need that. And then what happens is fear is such a thing that it strikes you twice. The second time it strikes you hard. 2016, January 29th, my heart shut down again at IIM Bangalore. This time in a much more complex way, that I could have died. But funnily enough, they saved me again. The doctors, medical science, rational scientific temper, God bless them. It's an irony to say God bless scientific temper, but anyway. But whichever way you like it, like, you know, so either scientific temper, I would like to believe scientific temper, but yeah, God and scientific temper, I'm back speaking to you here. So the second round of fear that hit me, where you actually saw that you could have died, so they put this small little lock kind of device here. So I am a walking Armageddon. I'm like cyborg. I have a high intensity pacemaker in my chest. So should I have a heart shutdown right now, I won't die. It'll simply shock me, which will be a good show for you. and then I will come back. So once I have had this in, we sold our company, Free Charge to Snapdeal, at $450 million, the largest exit for any e-commerce company in this country. So my... which also meant I made some money so that I can afford a jacket, which also led to me to do something which I always wanted to do from my college days, which is to work for Google. So I ended up becoming the head of mobile strategy for Google India for 2 years. And I am out right now here speaking to you with all confidence that fear is always going to pull you back, and it is okay to be afraid. At the moment I'm standing, I don't know who observed, I was sitting here, I was continuously checking my pulse just to make sure that I am under control so that I don't have an instance in stage. So I'm perpetually scared. The whole thing I'm wondering is, like, if I were not scared, I wouldn't have done all that what I did. So for everybody who's sitting over here who's feeling some amount of fear, it's a good thing. Don't say you're fearless. None of us are fearless. We all have some amount of fear. Deal with it. If I could almost die twice and come back and give a TEDx talk, you can actually do simpler things than that much easier. And so... and you're anyway studying engineering, how worse can it get? So, so do well, guys, and my no message, but the only thing that I want to leave you with, it's okay to be scared sometimes. It makes you a stronger person. At least my facade has improved. I'm still scared, but getting scared is not a bad thing. So just go ahead, do your thing, and you'll be fine. Thank you.